The single most important action we can take for our children and their future is to cure our addiction to fossil fuel. Combustion of coal, oil, gasoline, diesel, natural gas is the root cause of much of the ill health and developmental impairment of today's children and of their highly uncertain future. Now, why is this? Because the emissions include a multitude of toxic pollutants as well as carbon dioxide, CO2, a major driver of climate change. The young are now suffering disproportionately from both air pollution and climate change because of their inherently greater biological vulnerability. These health effects are not just abstractions or future projections. They're happening now, and not only in the developing world, but also in Europe, the US, and virtually every nation. So by reducing fossil fuel combustion and shifting to sustainable energy, we will see significantly less health damage from air toxics, fewer babies born at low birth weight or dying in infancy, fewer children with allergy, asthma, neurodevelopmental disorders like learning difficulty and ADHD, and fewer children at risk of cancer. We will see significantly less health damage from climate change, fewer children suffering from malnutrition, infectious disease, physical trauma from flooding and other disasters, mental ill health, respiratory problems, and heat-related illness. Let's consider just some of the toxic pollutants streaming from our smokestacks and vehicle tailpipes every day. Small respirable particles, black carbon, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, or PAH, nitrogen and sulfur dioxides, mercury, volatile chemicals that form ground-level ozone. All of this alongside massive amounts of CO2. Human activities emit 35 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere every single year, pushing the planet ever closer to temperatures considered catastrophic by experts. Now, while all age groups are affected, the developing fetus, infant, and child suffer the most from air toxics and climate change, because during these early stages, the brain, lungs, and other organs are developing in a dynamic and highly programmed way that can be disrupted by toxic exposures and other stressors. As an example of their rapid development, most of the 86 billion neurons or nerve cells in the human brain are formed during the prenatal period. The biological susceptibility of the young is magnified by inadequate nutrition and other stressors due to poverty. In fact, the World Health Organization estimates that children under 5 years bear more than 40% of the burden of disease caused by environmental factors, yet they constitute only 10% of the global population. And greater than 88% of the existing global burden of disease due to climate change falls on children, mainly in developing countries, but also worldwide. The numbers of children at risk are staggering. 1.9 billion out of the total world population of 7 billion are children below 15 years of age, and more than half of them are living in poverty. 1 billion poor children in the world. To illustrate the need for a holistic assessment of the harm of fossil fuel combustion to children's health and their future well-being, let us consider the multiple impacts of just a single class of combustion-related pollutants, the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, or PAH. Our research in Poland, the US, and China, following pregnant mothers and their children, has shown a link between prenatal exposure to PAH via the mother's environment during pregnancy and multiple adverse outcomes, lower birth weight and smaller head circumference, allergy and respiratory illness, developmental delays, lower IQ, and behavioral problems in childhood. And all of these impacts can have lifelong consequences for the children's health, their ability to learn, and their economic well-being. And we also have found evidence that material hardship due to poverty increases the harmful effect of prenatal PAH exposure on children's IQ. Now for some good news. Actions can make a difference. In Tongliang, China, my colleagues and I compared a cohort of children born before the government shut a centrally located coal power plant to another birth cohort conceived after plant closure. The second post-closure group had significantly lower levels of PAH pollutants bound to DNA in their cord blood, and they had higher levels of a protein important in early brain development called BDNF. And we no longer saw a significant effect of PAH exposure on cognitive outcomes in the children. On another level, the US EPA estimates that the economic value of avoided premature deaths and health costs, the benefits attributed to the regulation of particulate matter and other air pollutants by the US Clean Air Act amendments, will amount to almost $2 trillion for the year 2020. This amount dwarfs the direct costs of putting those limits into effect. And it is estimated that globally, up to $230 billion of avoided health costs annually by 2030 could be accomplished with an increase to 36% renewables in total energy consumption. Although incomplete, data such as these show that actions can make an immediate difference to the health of children. Now, what can we as individuals do to achieve the needed shift to energy conservation and sustainable energy? We can advocate and we can act. We can cite the scientific and economic evidence and advocate for harmonized and holistic environmental and climate policies at the community, state, and global levels, policies that place the well-being of children at their center. In our individual lives, we can reduce our carbon footprints by avoiding burning in the home, buying locally grown foods, driving energy-efficient vehicles, and using public transportation where possible. And through our consumer power, we can help shape markets toward green products produced sustainably. But above and beyond all the scientific and economic arguments for action is the moral imperative. As Pope Francis reminded us so forcefully last year in his encyclical Laudate Si, to protect our children and other vulnerable members of society.